Bob, it's Ross. Great to talk with you always. I was listening to you driving from Harrisburg to New York City yesterday. You sounded great, man. Enjoyed the coverage.
Thanks. Golf is it's better on radio than you think, right?
It is better on radio than I thought. You guys do a good job of moving it around. I love the voice, though. Like, when you went to broadcasting school, when did you learn the golf voice? Because I've heard you do boxing. I've heard you do the Giants. You get excited. You know, Mario Manningham, David Tyree, blah, blah, you know, back of the end zone. Like, I've heard all that. Who teaches you the golf voice?
You learn by trial of fire, my friend. And it was the 2003 Masters, or no, 2004 Masters. It was my second Masters. And I'm in the tower at 18. And our position is an open-air tower between the 18th and the 9th. And that's when Phil Mickelson and Ernie Els went mano a mano. And they're making birdies all over the golf course. So it was one of my holes on the front nine that I was calling off the monitor at that point. And Ernie Els made a birdie, and then Phil makes one on top of him. And you can hear the roars echoing from the patrons at Augusta National. And I kind of get into it a little bit, you know, and, you know, they've birdied it. Meanwhile, right below me at 18, Charles Howell III is just trying to finish up his Sunday and get out of there. So he's got a putt. I might have been for par, for birdie, whatever. And at the time, his dad was his caddy. And I turn around, and there's this glare staring up at me from his father because I had disrupted his putt. He had to step out of his putt and, you know, go through his thing all over again. And I quickly learned that you better get the hush down, because sometimes you're calling shots and things that are happening not near you or where we are between 9 and 18. I mean, I could be calling something at 9 and someone's putting out behind me at 18, so you got to be really careful not to disrupt the players.
Wow, so that's how you learned. You learned the hard way.
I learned the hard way with an icy glare from Charles Howell III's father.
Hey, can you say something about me, like me doing – can you just do something about me in the golf voice? I just want to hear you do me in the golf voice somehow, please.
I could try to do that.
All right.
I could try to do that. So Ross Tucker from Wyomissing, Pennsylvania. Blue slacks, gray shirt, blue cap. He's got 184 yards in here at 18. Tucker with a 6-iron. Looks up at the breeze one more time. Now he's set. Wide stance, brings the club back. Ball soaring on its way. Oh, and he hit a patron.
Oh, Bob, I thought I was going to make it. How can you do that? I thought I was going to cut that audio. I was going to have that forever and act like I was actually at the Masters. How can you do that to me?
Well, I'm just trying to keep it real, bro.
Dude, that is exactly how you sounded yesterday. That was amazing. I love how you talked about, was it Jordan Spieth or was it Willett, that he's now no longer wearing the sweater. He's just wearing a green shirt. One of those guys.
Yeah, that was Willett. Willett took his sweater off as he walked onto the green at 18, knowing that most likely he'd be fitted for a green jacket and that green shirt would look a lot better.
Oh, that is funny, man. Have you ever, I know you've been doing sports a long time. Have you ever seen anything quite as tough to watch or stomach as Spieth's 12th hole yesterday?
Well, we had Rory McIlroy about 5 years ago where he had a huge lead going into the second nine, and he took his tee shot and he hooked it into the cabins, and it was a train wreck from there on in. The thing that makes Spieth different is he's the defending champion. At that point, Rory hadn't won a major yet, even though he was a fantastic player, and he would later go on that year to win a couple of majors and sort of get that behind him. But here you have Spieth, who's the first guy to have the 54-hole lead as the defending champion since Ben Hogan in 1954, 7 straight rounds with the outright lead at Augusta, had never been done before, broke Arnold Palmer's record. He's going to become the youngest back-to-back Masters champion and the first Masters champion ever to go back-to-back and do it wire-to-wire. And then there's the sheer collapse. I mean, you know, number 10, all right, he didn't hit a great bunker shot. I could see the bogey. But you got a sense he was unraveling because he had been so clutch with these par-saving putts. And when he missed that, you know, 6.5, 7-footer at 11 for par, you're like, okay, here we go. But then, look, a lot of guys have made mistakes on Sunday at number 12. And even if he hits it in the water, all he has to do is, you know, figure out a way to make bogey off that. But he basically chunked it, playing his third shot from the drop area. I was stunned. And quite honestly, Ross, I love watching sports. I love being behind the mic calling sporting events, Super Bowls, regular season NFL games, whatever the case might be, golf every week on Golf Channel, boxing. But I don't like to see a guy completely fall apart. And that was actually hard to watch. I mean, you felt bad for him because it's not like the other sports where you could ask for a sub, you know, where the coach just says, oh, my God, that left tackle is getting destroyed. We got to get somebody else in there. I mean, you're still out there, and you still have to finish it out. And you're by yourself. There's nobody else playing but you. So it was really – it wasn't fun to watch, quite honestly. And then he came back with the birdies at 13 and 15, and he gave himself a chance at 16. And once he didn't make that at 16, you kind of felt that there was no way he was going to go birdie-birdie coming in to force a playoff.
Talking with Bob Papa, my good buddy, who works with me on NFL Radio, Sirius XM. He's also the voice of the Masters for Westwood One, all over the Golf Channel all the time. You can check out the PapaCast over at bobpapa.com. Bob, I had a tweet last night that it just, you know, seeing all these people, I was listening to sports talk radio, and I'm looking at Twitter, and all I'm hearing and reading is all these people talking about Jordan Spieth choking. I don't know what it was, but I just tweeted. I just got this really, really, really bad feeling, and I tweeted that there's something wrong about a bunch of people who have never been in a pressure situation in their life talking and writing about a 22-year-old choking. And I don't think I've ever had more, whatever they call it, verified people or whatever, you know, Trent Dilfer and Phil Dawson and Jay Feely and pretty much like five different kickers and punters in the NFL. Like, I'm just looking at my phone while we're talking, Bob. AJ McCarron, you know, just retweeted it while we're talking. And I'm not trying to say that you have to have played to be able to say that. I think it's more the word. But do you kind of understand where I'm coming from? I mean, he's 22 years old, and all these people that have never been anything close to that before are just talking and writing about how he choked. It just bothers me. It just doesn't feel right to me.
Yeah, I mean, it's sports. I mean, and there are going to be guys that give in to the pressure, and Spieth kind of admitted that afterwards. I mean, that's one of the things that you have to like about Jordan Spieth, and I know he's been criticized a little bit for how he handled himself in Butler Cabin, and he didn't shake Danny Willett's hand. He had literally just stepped off a car wreck. I mean, he was stunned. But if you look at his press gathering outside of the locker room a few minutes later, Jordan Spieth answered every question and answered them directly, and with his emotions and responded to every question that was asked of him, talking about what the collapse was like. And he said, you know, his mind was racing at 12, and when he hit the ball in the water with his tee shot, and then he just went too fast. But he said after the bogey at 11, you know, he should have taken a deep breath at 12 and played a safer shot, and then everything's going 1,000 miles per hour. You know, I think unless you've been in that arena, I don't think people really can understand. And you want to assign choke, you want to use that word and all that stuff. Yeah, he fell apart. He collapsed under the weight of trying to win back-to-back Masters. But isn't that kind of what pro sports is? Isn't that what happens to athletes day in and day out? Sometimes they just wind up not executing things that they've executed flawlessly for days or weeks or years. It happens. It's the human element of sports, which is why we watch it.
What about Danny Willett, Bob? I mean, is there anything to say about him other than he had a masterful final round?
Well, you know, he's number 12 in the world. In the official world golf rankings, Danny Willett, he's ranked 12. So it's not as if this was a guy that was ranked 458 and sort of, you know, won a Masters. He's got some pretty good pedigree. I mean, obviously the story of him almost not participating because yesterday was the due date of his first child, and they induced labor and he was able to play, and then it was his wife's birthday. I mean, there's all this symmetry. But, you know, Danny Willett also was able to play carefree golf in this regard. He was four groups ahead of Jordan Spieth. So Augusta National does not have electronic scoreboards like every other golf tournament. They have manual scoreboards that don't change instantaneously. It's not until the group is through that they're able to, you know, turn the flaps down and put the new scores up. So Danny Willett had no idea what was going on behind him. I'm sure the last time Danny Willett looked at a scoreboard, maybe as he's walking off the 11th green or he's heading to 14, at that point, Jordan Spieth is 7 under par, and Danny Willett had made a couple pars in a row. He's 5 shots off. So my guess is Danny Willett was able to play carefree golf and play in a relaxed state, and probably at this point he's thinking, you know what? I got a chance here for second. I can get a solo second here. You know, if I just play my game here and make a couple birdies coming in, I can move up the leaderboard, a lot of extra money. So he wasn't playing under the weight of knowing that he was actually in the lead or within contention until probably he got to 16 or 15, when then he could look up on the board and see that, you know, Jordan Spieth had gone bogey, bogey, quad. And suddenly everything had changed. Now, he executed a great shot at 17 off the back part of the green. At that point, he knows where he stands, so that was a huge pressure shot. But before that, he did not have to play under the weight of having a share of the lead and figuring out how to hold on or what he's got to do or to get to force it because he's within a shot. When he made his little run, for the most part, he thought in his mind he was 5 shots off the pace. That does change the dynamic a little bit, as opposed to if you're playing in that second group or that second to last group and you know exactly where you stand.
I think that's a really fair point. I got to ask you one football question before I get you out of here. I don't know how long you've been associated with the New York Giants. I know it's a long time. Have you ever seen them? 1988. Have you ever seen them spend like this? I can't remember anything even close to this.
You know, in 04 and 05, when they signed Kareem McKenzie from the Jets and they brought in Plaxico Burress and they signed Antonio Pierce and they made some other moves, at the time those were pretty lucrative contracts, which was sort of out of their character. And those players helped the Giants go on and win a Super Bowl. They also brought in Sean O'Hara in 2004. So they have done some things like that. I think the numbers now are just off the charts. But, you know, Ross, they realized that the talent level on the defensive side of the ball was lacking in so many areas that you can't fix it all right away. And I think they also realized that, look, the clock is ticking with Eli Manning. He's in his mid-30s at this point. And he's probably got 4 really good years in him. You know, by the time you wait for a couple of drafts to go by, he's going to be getting ready to retire. And then what? Then you're in that search, that never-ending search for the next quarterback. So I felt like they probably had to make these moves now, knowing that their quarterback, you know, is coming off 2 excellent years, and that, you know, the clock is now ticking. You know, there's more in the rearview mirror than there is looking forward.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense to me, Bob. Always great to talk with you, whether we're on the air together or not. Thanks so much for coming aboard, and great job yesterday. It's always fun to hear Bob Papa golf voice.
Hey, listen, anytime. And you know, Bernard Langer said something prophetic last week on my podcast when he said 1985, when he won for the first time and he was in contention, he said, hey, what's the difference between finishing second and 22nd? You might as well go for it. And we saw Danny Willett yesterday really go for it. And by the way, your guy Woosnam that you got the autograph from?
Yeah.
Even though this was Tom Watson's last Masters and, you know, that got all the play, Woosnam quietly announced that this would be his last Masters too, without much fanfare, but the body is just starting to break down. So just think, you got an autograph of a guy that's not playing in the tournament anymore.
Wow. Yep, time goes fast. Thanks so much, Bob.
You got it, Ross, anytime.
The Dan Patrick Show, weekday mornings on Audience.